Good morning, everybody. Happy Halloween. I'm so glad that you're here, and welcome to all of our friends at home. We are all gathered today to celebrate and just praise God, and I'm so glad that you're here with each of us. If you're at home, I hope that you will let us know you're there. Just say hello, and where are you watching us from? We'd love to know. So today is a day of just celebration. We're going to have some fun. It's Halloween, so we're going to see some crazy hats and stuff around. And we just want you to be a part of the community. And this week is a busy week here at Trinity. Tonight at 6:30, we are having trick-or-treat here on the church grounds. So if you have children or you know children or grandchildren, come on down at 6:30 here at the church. And there is a treat for adults as well, because the band will be playing, and you'll be able to enjoy some music during the trick-or-treating. So hope all of you will be there for that. Then next Saturday, we have our Blessing of the Pets at 9:30 under the trees. So bring your pets and invite your neighbors. It's a great time to invite people here to the church as well. Just continue to look at the announcements. We have a chili cook-off in the afternoon for the preschool next Sunday. Our Operation Christmas Club boxes are available and being filled. There's just a lot of things going on now as we're in the ministry for Christ. So hope you will take a look at the announcements and figure out how you want to be a part of what's going on here at Trinity. But we are so glad that you are here this morning. It's a great day to be here in worship. So let's continue to open our eyes and our hearts to God, and let's praise God. Amen?
We celebrate. The joy is feeling away. The joy is feeling the side of the grave. And you fight to try to be lost. And we fight for freedom for the world. The weight of our burdens to carry it all. Tears in my face, the dead on the cross, the dead on the stars. We move mountains, regular times, Jesus is crying out for the pain. We let the world up, the sun is warm, great is the moon, great is the heart. I'm going to take you to the miracle of the we are God.
We have a perfect Halloween song. It's called "Who Shall I Fear?"
God is always by our sides. And we remember that as we go to time of prayer. We remember that God is with us. And that we are part of a great hour. That we walk with each other. And I'm sorry to let you know that we've lost the number of the church. George Pierce died this week. And so we ask that you keep your prayers, be with him. By our sins. Let us pray. God, some days life overwhelms us. Some days the fear, the confusion, the uncertainty of life makes it where we can't move forward. But you continually remind us that you're already there, that you have gone before us, and you are walking with us. When you went to the cross for us, Lord, you paved the way. You forgave the forgiveness of our sins. You conquered death to remind us that there's nothing standing in front of us that you haven't taken care of. Forgive us for our doubt. Forgive us for our uncertainty. Help us truly draw to you, Lord. Help us to focus on you as our hope and our Savior. And as during a cloudy day, the sun breaks through, you break through the fog of depression and fear. We pray, Holy Spirit, that you will fall down on each of us today, wherever we are. That we will open our hearts to you, knowing that you know what is in our hearts. No matter how ugly we think it is, you know and you still love us, Lord. And when you say, you are my child, we pray your Holy Spirit will bring comfort to those grieving. Will bring strength to those trying to find a new way. Will bring hope to those that just see darkness. We pray, Lord, that you will help those that are fighting addiction, that their strength is your strength. We pray that you will be with parents just feel a little overwhelmed, trying to be the person in the family to keep things stabilized. We are yours, Lord. We know that you call us to do your work, but we don't do it alone. That you are there with us, walking and preparing the way, calling us to actions that you have confidence in us to do. So fill us, Lord. Fill us with your presence, your confidence, your hope. We are yours. Help us, Lord, to go forward and to do your work in this world that so desperately needs you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
I'm going to go to the hospital.
What we're talking about today. That is who we are, or who God is for us. The God who never stops. The God who is always at work in our lives and the world, even when we can't see it. And calling us to be part of that. Would you pray with me as I pray for you? Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Open our hearts and our minds to speak to us. Help us to hear your particular message to us. You know what we need to hear, Lord. And I pray, Lord, the words I say are yours. Talking about the Lord's Prayer. And that that's what the song that we just sang symbolizes. That the Lord's Prayer is that reminder of Jesus' ministry in our lives. A reminder of Jesus always at work, never stopping, always working, and calling us to be part of that. The Lord's Prayer, it is, when you sit down and look at it, it is Jesus' ministry, why he came to us. Now, prayer is a mystery. And for many people, praying, when we ask to pray the Lord's Prayer, as we're doing the sermon series, I'm asking everybody to pray 3 times a day the Lord's Prayer. And I hear a lot of people with just prayer in general that come to confession for me. You don't know Methodists do confession, but they do. They come to me and they want to be absolved. And one of the biggest prayer requests is, I don't like to pray. I don't understand prayer. Prayer doesn't come naturally to me. I see other people praying and it just flows from their lips. And I struggle with prayer. Well, I'm going to absolve all of you right now. Whatever we have to do for confession, right? I'm not a good Catholic. I'm absolving you because prayer is hard. It's difficult. It isn't natural. We have to be vulnerable. And it's something that we just, it's difficult. But I am not absolving you of not doing it. I'm absolving you of the guilt that we have to continue to try. Prayer is something that Jesus calls us all to do, and we have to work at it. It's just like any relationship. The key to any relationship is what? Communication. Good communication. And prayer is our communication with our Savior. It is opening up our hearts and to whoever you pray to, whether it's God, Jesus, the Holy Spirit. It is developing that time of just being honest. There are no specific words that have to be said. There's no elegant way of saying it. It's just being honest. What prayer is. It's that developing our communication with God, that relationship. That's why we're spending some time this month talking about the Lord's Prayer. To get a better understanding of it, how to use it, what it means, and to get more comfortable. Now, there are two in our scripture, there are two Lord's Prayers. One in Matthew, which we read last week, and now I'm going to read the one from Luke, in Luke 11. One day, Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples. He said to them, when you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, give us each day our daily bread, forgive us our sins, as we also forgive everyone who sins against us, and lead us not into temptation. It's a little different from the Matthew one. But the same point is there of how we are to use this prayer and to take it forward in our lives. We are praying to God who offers us an invitation to come for ourselves. Now, many times we pray for intervention, don't we? We want God to give in and change something, intervene. And sometimes we are blessed to see a miraculous intervention. But most of the time, God answers prayer through us. We go back to that first word of our Father at the beginning of the prayer. God answers prayer through us. If we pray for healing, God answers that prayer through a doctor who has skills. Or maybe an urge or new idea that he has for treatment. We pray that we are lonely. God answers prayers through somebody by saying, you know, give them a call. Go by. Say hi. We are the answers to God's prayers. And last week we did the first petition, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And today we continue with the next. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. So just as we have looked at earth as sort of our sphere, our place, and heaven is all the other, but we also know that there's that overlap, because God's kingdom is here. And God's kingdom is coming here, and we are to do the work to prepare for it. It is a marriage of both. So when we say, Thy kingdom come, it is a reminder to each of us that God's kingdom isn't what we expect. It's different than what we think the answer should be many times. God's kingdom, and we look at Jesus' ministry. God's kingdom is one of peace. God's kingdom is one of justice. God's kingdom is one of a reversal of power. Think about it. Jesus called the children to him. Children were non-people in society then. And yet, Jesus identified them and drew attention to them and said, these are my children. Listen to them. He drew all his attention to Zacchaeus, a tax collector, who he went to his house. Tax collectors were people on edge. Nobody liked tax collectors. I know it's the same today, right? Nobody liked tax collectors. And yet, Jesus said, Zacchaeus, I'm going to your house with your friends. People that were not okay to everybody. And yet, he showed that they're part of the kingdom. And the woman at the well, with his son, and she was sunning herself even for a lifestyle that wasn't approved of. And yet, Jesus went to her and talked to her about being thirsty and that he had the water of life to give to her. That's what the kingdom is. And when we pray this prayer, Thy kingdom come, it's a reminder to us that it's Thy kingdom, not mine. Now, we live in a society right now that is obsessed with us, right? And I can tell you why, because we do this. All of our pictures, how many? Let me find you. Okay, wave. We're going to do a selfie. Are you waving? So I can see you waving. Okay. Think about selfies. Who is in the center of a selfie? In this one, I am. And then you selfie stick you know, it's great, you include a lot of people, but we're at the center. And we're in a society right now that's a selfie society. We have to put ourselves at the center. We think that this is the way the world should work. And the Lord's Prayer is a reminder to us that it's Thy kingdom, God's kingdom, not ours. It is the ultimate, the Lord's Prayer is the ultimate anti-selfie. It is that reminder to us that we have to get out of the center and we have to get focused back on the kingdom that Jesus taught us about. Now that's what the Lord's Prayer is about. We are to pray and get to work. There is a phrase, a Latin phrase, and I was in an online workshop conference where Adam Hamilton was talking about the next book he's writing, and it's going to be on the Lord's Prayer. So, but I didn't want to wait. I really liked that idea. I was like, "It'll be a great sermon series." So I'm sorry, I'm doing it now, and you can buy his book when it comes out to see what I missed. But he did make a comment on this Latin phrase, ora et laboro. And it means, basically, to pray and work. When we pray the Lord's Prayer, to really understand the Lord's Prayer, we have to pray it and then get to work with it. That is the ultimate thing. We are to do the work of Jesus. Jesus taught his disciples, his followers, and then they were to go out. He equipped them to go out, just as each of us is equipped and encouraged to go out to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. We have to get to work to make the Lord's Prayer real. We can't just pray it. That's nice, I feel better. We have to pray it, understand it, and work it. You know, when you're exercising, you got to work it to get some results. Well, we got to work this prayer, and that's key. N.T. Wright says this about this prayer. He uses it as an example of where Jesus is a medical genius who has invented penicillin. And then gives it to the doctors to go out and use or spread to help people. Or think of it as a composer, where Jesus creates this beautiful symphony and then gives it to the conductor to pull together and pull many people together and take that beautiful music out and share it with others. Well, it's like that for us as the followers that Jesus is giving us the kingdom. And we are to take it out and teach it and live it with others. It's our job to get out there, get it done, to get out there and make the kingdom happen. Anybody feeling a little pressure right now? Lost, isn't it? And so it's important, as we're living in a salty world, it's important for us to hear that we're to take this, Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We're to get out there and to show people Jesus and to take the teachings of Jesus and make them real. Sometimes that means listening to the nudges that come, that God's using us. Maybe somebody has come to your mind while you're praying. Somebody that maybe has been praying for because they're lonely. And God has put it on your mind to give them a call and go visit or invite them to lunch. But you're the answer to prayer. And when we don't answer that prayer and accept it, then the prayer doesn't get answered for the other person. So we have to listen to God as we're praying. So listen. But then what we do is give us this day our daily bread. We are reminded that God comes to us daily, that we are to go to God daily. Think about the manna for those in exile. God provided manna for them in exile, but it wasn't, I'll give you a week's supply. It was to go out and harvest it daily. We have to go to God daily, and that's learning to pray and open ourselves up and be vulnerable to God. That God will show us the signs of the kingdom. Think about it. He feeds our needs. He fed the needs of the 5,000. He fed the needs of the woman at the well. Whether it's physical or spiritual, God knows our needs. And in that daily prayer, we quench our hunger and our thirst. God knows our desires. And a lot of people go, oh, yes. I don't like to pray. I don't want to let God in. I don't want God to see what's in my mind and heart. What do you want? God won't like it. God already knows. But when you invite God, God's already there. But it is that sense of being vulnerable and saying, God, I need you. And I'm willing to work with you. It is putting our desires and needs into words. So when we are reminded to pray daily, it is to go to God daily. And God will fill us and give us our needs. And when we pray, we are being called to go and do. We don't just pray. It's like, okay, we pray, and now what are you going to do with it? What are you going to do? Maybe you're praying for our world that we won't pollute it so much. We want to save animals, because we need our prayers to be very specific. But then what are you going to do about it? When you go walk on the beach, do you pick up trash when you see it in front of you and put it in the trash can and say, okay, God, I'm doing my part? I know of a church that was struggling like all during the pandemic, trying to figure out what to do. How do you be a church during a pandemic? They had the ecumenical food pantry there on their campus. It was run by another organization. And at one point in the pandemic, that organization decided it wasn't safe for their volunteers, and they just didn't know how to negotiate it all, and so they shut it down. And the pastor of that church really felt strongly that it wasn't okay, that there were people hungry, and that the church needed to do something. And so the church went to them and told them, we'll keep running it until you feel like you're able to come back. Now, they didn't have the access to the food banks, and so they put out the word, and we need food. And the community started rallying, and the church started rallying. And it gave the church a sense of purpose in the midst of losing everything. And people were reminded, all will be done. That we're a part of the kingdom, and we have to pray, but then we have to go and do. go and do. Give us this day our daily bread. God hears our specific prayers. God loves us. Warts and all. God loves us. And calls us to be the answer. We are to be the answer for others. It is up to us to respond. We have to respond. So our prayer is not only for our own education and praying to God, but it's also to equip us to respond. To respond to who God wants us to be. So during this month, the sermon series, I'm inviting you to pray the Lord's Prayer daily. At least once a day, and if not more. To think about each phrase, to slow it down, and to pray a prayer. If you're driving, instead of turning on the radio, instead, listen to the prayer. Pray just one phrase and one petition. And think about what it means for you that day. How am I called to respond today in this way? Somebody's telling me right now they need my help. God reaches out to us and will give you those opportunities to serve others. So it is time for us to pray and to get to work. You are part of the answer. You are part of the answer. We need to move away from the selfie world and become part of the kingdom. The hour. And do our part. I invite you now to stand as we pray the Lord's Prayer together. Pray this prayer, and we're going to pray it slow and think about what these words mean for you today. And where God may be nudging you. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, not ours. Thy will be done, not ours, yours. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Every day we get to go to you, Lord. And forgive us. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Thank you. Means that when you're praying and something better comes in your mind, an opportunity is in front of you, that you pray and go. Or if God is answering your prayer, if somebody calls or offers help, we say yes and allow others to be part of the answer. So now, this week, pray and go as Jesus calls us to do. And all God's people said, amen.
You are born to all the